Okay, welcome to our Duke journey into the hybrid cloud. First, some introduction about Audi and myself. I guess all of you, or I hope all of you know Audi. We build cars, actually quite a lot, and this is done by quite a number of employees worldwide. So as you can imagine, this process alone generates quite a lot of data. So our big data platform is quite important. I don't work directly for Audi, but for Audi Business Innovation. We are a Munich-based subsidiary of Audi, focusing on trying out new business for Audi, but also providing IT solutions for Audi. And that's the department I work for. And so we build Java cloud application, mobile applications, virtual reality. We do a lot there. And of course, my focus is on big data, and since 1 year, also on the cloud. Yeah, my name is Carsten. I've been working for Audi for 4 years by now as a platform and a solution architect. I helped building up the on-premise platform at Audi, bringing the first applications live on that platform last year. And since 1 year, I'm focusing on extending the Hadoop platform into the cloud, which will be the talk today. Okay, when we look at our analytics platform at Audi, how we call it, we serve first quite a lot of different number of capabilities. Not all of these are really big data related, but more traditional business intelligence related. We serve at the center of competence of big data and BI at Audi. We deliver platforms as shared platforms to all our internal customers, who then eventually build solutions on top of these platforms. A few years ago, this landscape changed a little bit, so we had to introduce new technologies because we had new requirements from different lines of business, like production, like quality assurance, and also from online car data. So we started to introduce Hadoop as our big data platform, Kafka as our streaming platform. And last year, we decided to extend this platform into the cloud. And why we did this and how we did this, I will explain in this presentation. I have to note that this analytic platform is not the only big data platform at Audi. And Audi is a little bit divided and in different areas. So we are serving here, collecting all the data as a data lake and analytical platform for all the data that generated while the car is built and all time afterwards when it's sold and after sales and quality assurance. So as you can imagine, when you develop a new car, you generate quite a lot of test data that's handled on a different platform, as well as autonomous driving is not handled on this platform. Okay, why cloud, yeah? But just because everyone is doing it these days? Definitely not. So we had a number of reasons driving to the cloud. The first one is kind of data locality. Audi has recently started to move his applications from the data center in Ingolstadt, where the headquarters of Audi is in the south of Germany, into the cloud. So that means that our data sources that feed into our data lake and our analytical platform also move to the cloud. Then the second one is scalability. Especially with Hadoop and the on-premise world, we use a Hadoop appliance. So scalability is not that easy. We have to extend the appliance, getting a new appliance. It's a quite cost-intensive process. So yeah, this is difficult. That also means that on-premise, we only actually have two physical stages. We have a development cluster and we have a production cluster. And the development cluster then is logically divided into development and integration. This doesn't make things really easy, and it makes hard to try out new features, new releases, because we have to do this on development machine. That means we affect a lot of people and teams using that cluster. And of course, functionality. We have requirements from the projects. We just learned in the talk before this, yeah, GPUs are highly on demand. We also need a more flexible staging process. I go into that later in a little bit more detail. And also we want to make use of the cloud native services that you can get, like S3, like database services, Docker registry. We need for our workloads, but which are not really our core competence as a big data platform. And yeah, so we would like to reduce our work on infrastructure here. But of course, we didn't want to just create some big data platform in the cloud and have another big data platform on premise and in two silos. That's something we really want to avoid. So our goal is to really create a kind of hybrid solution. And what does this mean or why? Currently, as you have seen in the capability matrix, a lot of our systems are still running only on-premise. We have all our data warehouse on-premise. We have our reporting tool on-premise. We don't want to move everything in the cloud now, and we don't want to duplicate everything in the cloud as well to reduce operational cost, to reduce license cost. And of course, some data sources will always remain on-premise, like the manufacturing data or some very critical data that we currently don't want to move to the cloud. So I think the on-premise platform will stay there for quite a while. I'm somehow fighting with this remote. Okay. So what's the idea of having a hybrid platform, like one platform? Like write once, run everywhere. So when we develop a job for the on-premise platform, we want to be able to easily move that job, usually that's a Spark job or some Hive job, to the cloud. So that means we need the identical stack we have on-premise, we also need in the cloud, because otherwise it's not possible. So we want to have Hortonworks we used on-premise. We also want to use it in the cloud. And we want to make sure we really have the same identical version of Spark on the productional clusters to be able to really shift the workloads. Then, of course, we need some single sign-on, not just for the users, which is more easier for them, but they must be able to shift data from on-premise to the cloud and vice versa. And we also now have the first projects that want to make use of both components. So you have to be able not to only have workloads on different platforms, but also to exchange data between the platforms. And finally, of course, we always want to share the metadata, because in the end, we would like to know where's our data. Yeah? Before I dive into the technical things, how we set up the platform, when we introduced when we moved to the cloud, we also changed the way we worked and our department at Audi. In the past, usually when you introduce a new technology, you looked for a partner, you specified the requirements, and the partner delivered some solution and then handed it over to you and probably even ran it for you. For us, this platform, all this big data, this analytical solutions is becoming more and more crucial for our new digital services. So we decided we need more of this knowledge and capabilities in-house. So we changed the way we worked a little bit. So we had a mixed team of Audi and Audi Business employees, which we consider kind of internal team, and also an external team, not just with one partner, but with two partners. And also at some points of time, we had dedicated support by Hortonworks. The team was distributed more or less over two countries and four cities. We had quite a lot of different nationalities. So how did we make this work? How could the team work together? So we chose an agile approach. It's Scrum-based, or actually it is Scrum. We have every week we meet for 2 days for on-site workshops in Ingolstadt at the Audi offices, where we really work together, where we do some meetings, where we do the planning and the reviews of Scrum, of course, but also just use the time to work on-site together to have a really good exchange between the team members and to make sure we have a good knowledge transfer from the externals to the internals. Of course, we use the standard tools like Jira, Bitbucket, RocketChat for communication and collaboration. The goals of this approach was really to get the experts of the various topics together, because to be honest, for speaking for myself and then most of my colleagues, we haven't had really a lot of expertise with cloud or AWS, but we needed this knowledge. And so we tried to find people who support, who had that knowledge and brought that knowledge into this team. And in the end, with all these experts, we wanted to build a team to deliver the platform. And I have to say, of course, there was some hiccup when we initiated this, but after time, this really worked well for us. Okay, how does it look like? We have 3 weeks sprints. So 2 weeks, the first week and the second week, we just read in our project office and do our more or less daily work, but on-site together, sitting together in a room, going to lunch together. And then in the third week, the sprint ends. So we did our review, our retro, our planning. We didn't do daily calls. For those who scrum, you know, usually one time a day you'd have kind of stand-up call. We didn't do that because we had a few people on the project who didn't work full-time on the project. And for them, it doesn't make sense to join into a daily call. So we had 2 calls a week. We met in person and we haven't had any regular calls. But we did some calls on demand. When we develop a new feature, we don't do it on the master branch on Git, of course. We use some feature branch before we merge it. And if it's a bigger change, we do a meeting to have everyone on the line, what has been changed, what are possible side effects that could happen before merging this into the master branch. And also, as we introduce quite a lot of new technologies, we had to discuss a little bit, how will we do things, what's the best way to do it, and this decision shouldn't be taken by one person alone, but also within the whole team. So we had this ad hoc design meetings. If there was an important decision to make, which could not wait until the next on-site meeting, we had a call for it. And of course, especially for the review, we had an alignment with our on-premise team that runs an on-premise cluster to make sure that there's also some knowledge spread. Okay, now I'm coming more to the more technical details, so to the choice of technologies. If we move to the cloud, if you've seen AWS was already set for us, yeah, because Audi decided to use AWS, the other systems went there, so it makes no sense for us to look for another cloud provider. But still, there were a lot of choices we had to make. So for us, clear, if you move to the cloud, you want to automate your infrastructure. Yeah? You don't want to go to the AWS console and click everything together and don't know in the end what everyone did. So you have to use some automation framework. You could either use CloudFormation by AWS or Terraform being the most popular. And we decided to go for Terraform. We didn't do a really in-depth comparison of these tools. The main driving reason for us at Audi was this was already used by a lot of other projects. So especially at Audi Business Innovation, I had quite a lot of colleagues who had a lot of experience with that and helped us setting up the initial scripts, doing some reviews with us, and also helping us if we ran into some problems. Then for configuration management, how you do it, you can integrate some bash commands, some shell commands into Terraform. You can use Ansible. There are also some other tools. We started just with Terraform, and we were just with a few lines of bash commands inside the Terraform scripts. But with the time, all this became too complex. And then we decided, OK, we switch from all this bash code, shell code, and our Terraform scripts to Ansible. So we first run Terraform to set up the AWS infrastructure. And then we run Ansible to set up the infrastructure on our host, deploy the software, do some configuration. I'm not speaking of Hadoop yet. This is coming hopefully now. Yeah, if you look into Hadoop deployments, if you do Hortonworks, there are the Ambari blueprints. I don't know, anybody of you is using Ambari blueprints? A few. And then there's this quite new tool called Cloudbreak by Hortonworks, and we really tried it out. And Cloudbreak also uses Ambari blueprints, so it's not really exclusive or. But Cloudbreak offers really some great possibilities if you just want to spin up a cluster in the cloud rather quickly. It spins up the machines for you. I think it also sets up some VPC at AWS. But we had some requirements to integrate with all our other infrastructure at Audi, the infrastructure we have in the cloud and the infrastructure we have on premise. And for us, this was too difficult. We didn't see how we really could do this with Cloudbreak. And besides the blueprint you could put into some versioning, we didn't see, at least not at that time of point when we looked into Cloudbreak, how could we do a versioning of all the configuration we did in the Cloudbreak console. So we decided to stay with Ambari blueprints, with which we started. And then a big question about user management. I don't know, maybe some of you have attended my presentation last year in Berlin about our on-premise cluster. We haven't had really a centralized user management there for particular reasons. In the cloud, we were more free, and as we were more flexible and spinning up clusters, destroying clusters, doing this manual user management on all the machines was really no option for us. So we thought, okay, we need to integrate with some centralized solution. And by now, we cannot integrate with Audi Active Directory. So what we chose was free IPA. It took us some time to set up free IPA, to integrate it. We integrated on the host level so that the users can log in onto the machines with their free IPA users. As you will see later, we also integrated with all the other Hadoop services like LDAP. We use KDC of free IPA. I will go into the details later as well. And what came in really handy for us, that is also offered DNS. Because on-premise DNS solution we couldn't use in the cloud, and we needed a solution of our own and didn't want to use all the cryptic Amazon names all the time. So as by now, you know a little bit the tech stack. Let's take a look into the architecture. Let's first start on-premise. In the middle, you can see we have our data zone, where we have our Hadoop cluster and our data warehouse. Our Hadoop cluster, of course, it's a multi-platform, so it's Kerberized. We have our own KDC there. It's an MIT KDC. Besides that, Kafka is used quite a lot for streaming, because with all these new big data use cases, one of the biggest changes was that the data usually doesn't come in batches, it comes in streams. It's generated all the time by sensors mainly, or from our cars driving around. Then, of course, the data must be presented somehow to the business users. There we have in our application zone, we have different tools with our data warehouse and Hadoop. We mainly use Tableau. And for collecting our log files, mainly for operational things on the platform, but also for log files from Spark jobs of the application itself, we use Splunk. And then we moved to the cloud. We set up, that wasn't done by our department, but by the networking department of Audi, hub and spoke architecture. You'll see it later in detail. So our cluster is located in Frankfurt. We spun up a new cluster there. We have our own KDC. We have the free IPA there and our deploy automation. One of our data sources is currently in an island. This is the reason they are there, is they started earlier, like 1 or 2 years earlier, and some of the functionality they required wasn't available at Frankfurt at that point of time. And what we really did in the beginning, in the kind of POC phase, before we really start and looking how to build up the productional environment, was how can we connect all these things together? Because if you work in a big enterprise, you just cannot connect to host or to services together. Yeah, there are quite a lot of firewalls, of course, in between. There has to be a lot of routing configurations to be done to enable this, and to be allowed to do this, of course, you need clearance by your IT security department. So fortunately for us, we have a direct connect set up between Ingolstadt and the data set in Frankfurt. So we have a connection here. Still, we have a new firewall at Ingolstadt. It's called the Cloud Firewall. So that's somehow protects internal on-premise systems from the systems that run in our cloud. And to be able to communicate for the routing, we have this architecture I will explain later. Let's look a little bit more in detail how the network architecturing works. This is a general setup for Audi. So in the on-premise world, we have our local router. And in the cloud, we have our hub VPC with a Cisco router. So each team or each project gets its dedicated IP range, which we use. And then the traffic is automatically routed to the corresponding range. So if we want to access some other systems, some of our source systems, we don't have to do any VPC peering with them. We don't have to discuss with them how we do the routing. We know for sure that our IP ranges don't overlap. That makes things much easier when you want to connect a lot of different systems in the cloud. And so one of these spoke VPCs is our cluster, and I will zoom into this now. At least I'm trying. Okay, this is how our Hadoop cluster looks like. At the right-hand side, we have different clusters for the different features we're using at the moment. We just labeled them with different colors. They have nothing to say really in particular. What you can see at the bottom is your typical Hadoop cluster. At the moment, we don't have high availability in our clusters. We are more focusing on connecting everything, on making the cluster available to the projects, and HA we will introduce soon. So for each cluster, we have an Ambari node, we have some data nodes, we have our own local MIT KDC still, we have master node. For the data nodes, we currently use two different types of data nodes. We use like normal HEP worker nodes where we store data in HEFS, where we use YARN for running jobs like Hive and Spark. And we have a few dedicated data nodes to run Hive Interactive on them. And there's no data stored on these nodes, they're just used for compute. Of course, we need some connection to the internet. We need some connection to our hub VPC. And what we did is that we didn't use built-in databases that come deployed when you deploy the Hadoop cluster. We wanted to have a more reliable solution here. So we use an AWS service, this, and this slide's already a little bit outdated. We use Aurora. Postgres, so database management is really now at a minimum level for us. As we were one of the first projects already to move to the cloud, especially to Frankfurt, we had to set up quite a lot of things you take for granted when you build up a platform on the on-premise world. And this is all the stuff that's on the left-hand side. So of course, we must somehow be able to access the Hadoop cluster to deploy our solutions. So of course, we have to make sure our cluster and all our servers are not openly accessible from all over the internet. So we set up a bastion host we used to jump onto the Hadoop cluster or onto our deployment host. The deployment host actually then is used where the Terraform is run and the Ansible is run to deploy the different Hadoop clusters. So Hadoop clusters, we use quite a lot of instances for development, just new features. We just deploy them when we test something and we tear them down afterwards. All these components on the left-hand side in our management VPC, they are, of course, much more static. They're there all the time, like the free IPA. Of course, we have a second instance for development, but mainly we have one instance running there, actually on two nodes for the user management. We also started to use S3. We started using the Terraform state there. We use Vault by HashiCorp to store all our credentials, which integrates quite well with Terraform and Ansible. We use it for backup of the data we have in HDFS. And we also offer us like kind of new service for the projects to offload some data from HDFS to S3. Another service we are not yet using, but we will use quite soon in the future. This is the ECR registry, the Elastic Container Registry of AWS. When we move to the cloud, we also switch from Hadoop 2.6 to HTTP 3.0. So now we have this possibility to run Docker containers under Yarn. And this is a feature we've been waiting for quite a long of time because we had a use case where we thought that would really help us. That is running the Kafka Confluent connectors and in Docker containers. At the moment, we run all these connectors on our edge nodes, which doesn't scale very well and also has some security implications. And putting them into Docker containers really makes our life easier. But then, of course, if we want to run Docker containers under Yarn, you need some registry somewhere. So how do we do the user management? I don't know how familiar with the free IPA. Free IDA comes with a built-in KDC. Still, we decided to have a local KDC on each cluster. So when we install a Hadoop cluster, we still set up this MIT, local MIT KDC, and all the service principles are created in that local KDC. Of course, all our users, named users or technical user for projects, they are in the free IPA KDC. So we have a one-way trust between the KDCs that we can use the principle from our free IPA KDC to access any of the clusters if we allow to do so. Yeah, that's I'll talk about it in a few minutes, how we make sure only the users that are allowed to access the cluster and run jobs, they really can do that. And also this one-way trust is not on the slide, we do with our on-premise KDC. So we can use the principles from the on-premise cluster to access the clusters in the cloud, to use disk copy jobs or to run jobs locally on the cloud, which is important. We use one-way trust here by purpose, because at the moment the on-premise infrastructure is still considered to be more secure than the cloud infrastructure. So we want to make sure that not if someone has a principal in the cloud, he can access anything on on-premise. That way around it doesn't work, it just works in one direction. To make sure that the users can only access the clusters they are supposed to access, you have to look at security at the different levels. First, on the OS level, this is handled by free APA. So we have the users in different groups for the different clusters and can make sure by configuring this in free APA that only a certain group is allowed to access a certain cluster. Then also we use these groups from free IPA, we sync them with Ranger we have on each of the cluster to make sure that only the users that are allowed to submit jobs to Yarn on the cluster are able to do so. This took us actually quite some time to set up all this infrastructure to make this work, but I think it was really worth it because now managing user access, it's much more easy and much more straightforward and much more clearer who has access to which cluster, and it's all the users essentially managed in this free IPA. Okay, what are the lessons learned? Yeah, like with great freedom we found in the cloud, there were hardly any rules for us. I mean, there were some rules probably from Audi, yeah, but nobody really made sure we followed these rules. So we were all on our own. And we didn't want to be the first Audi project who had a kind of database or Hadoop cluster worldwide readable and enabled AWS deployed. So you have to do everything yourself. You really have to make sure the infrastructure you set up is really secured and only the people who are supposed to access it can really access it. the things you take for granted and on-premise, like having DNS, LDAP, routing, these are things usually I didn't have really to think about, and all the projects I did on-premise. Now you really have to take care of this, and not just configuring it, also supplying solutions for it. The automation really pays off. We can spin up clusters quite quickly. It takes around, I think, half an hour to spin up a cluster. That is, so the AWS gateway, the NAT gateway takes like 5 minutes, 10 minutes to spin up. And then of course, Ambari deployment, when you install the cluster, it takes another 10, 15 minutes usually, depending on the services you have configured. But it really pays off, because every change you do, you can spin up the cluster, you see that it works. We have developed a test suite, so we can run this test suite every time we deploy the cluster and can be sure that all of the things we've configured and tested before still work. And of course, security really must be considered from the start. You cannot start with an unsecured environment in the cloud and then, okay, I think about security later. That's probably never a really good idea. For the project setup, the agile approach really paid off well for us. So the progress we made in the project was really good and fixed. Of course, we really need a strong involvement of the product owner. Yeah? That was something new for me. It's the first time I was in this really product owner role. You really have to be available for the team all the time. There have been a lot of questions. And of course, the downside of having distributed teams is it costs a lot of traveling time. This led to some discussions, of course, because usually people don't like to travel that much, at least not regularly. It's not always Barcelona. Ingolstadt is probably a little bit less popular than here. But still, they really learned that the time spent together and working together and having some discussions face to face and having a lunch together or going for beer in the evening, that really helps building the team. And with the team, we found that at our partners, but also at Audi, of course, you have some fluctuations. So some team members left, some other peer team members come in. So the team is changing constantly. And we have to make sure that the team works together quite well with these new members onboarded quite quickly. And for the fluctuation, of course, you have to distribute the knowledge. And I think this is here also where this agile approach really helps. Because before we do a merge from a feature branch into the master, we always do a peer review. We do these merge meetings where at a more higher level, we explain to the whole team what we are doing. Of course, it takes some time where the others are not working. But this way, we make sure everybody has a really good understanding of the whole picture. And that also helps if you're changing one part, makes much more easier to identify of possible side effects. Okay, it's a journey, and I don't know if the journey has really a final destination. I don't see it for the next year, so there are still quite a lot of things to do. And one thing we really want to improve in the very near future is the staging process we have on our on-premise world, where we have development and integration, sharing one physical cluster. We really want to divide this and move more stages to the cloud, so we won't have all stages on-premise and in the cloud, but then we don't have to share the physical environments, and this would even help us if we have to do kind of upgrade or configuration change on the on-premise, on the integration cluster, testing it before moving it to prod without affecting all the developers, because the development cluster is used quite heavily. There are a lot of projects. There's always a lot of load, at least during the business hours, so it's very hard to find a slot to say, okay, the cluster's not available for a day. That really hurts a lot of people. And what I fear, that's the approach we are already using. So for every feature we develop, we use a dedicated cluster, test the code there, make sure it works, review it, and then merge it into the main cluster. So this is not for the project, this is more for the infrastructure side. And of course, this gives us some flexibility you can never dream of in working just in an on-premise environment. Yeah, there's still some roadmap. I've said we have a lot of machine learning projects, POCs, but also some projects already that's already live at Audi going on, and the demand for GPUs is coming. Also, the demand for moving some older data into an offline storage. We don't have to keep all the data on Hadoop all the time. And one of the benefits of the cloud is you can use some technology as a service. At the moment, we run a Kafka cluster. It's not a Hortonworks cluster, it's a Confluent cluster on-premise. We think about moving it to the cloud. At the moment, we don't have to do it because the first project, the first data source we are using, they're using Kafka as well. So we're using their cluster. We don't need a dedicated one, but I think quite soon we will need a dedicated cluster in the cloud. And you really can reduce your work on infrastructure and work on infrastructure operations and then more focus on delivering some real business applications. Yeah, for machine learning, as I said, the NUTs with GPU, but also the data science workbench, which is now kind of available for Hortonworks, now Cloudera customers, is something we want to look into for giving the data scientists and analysts a better tool. And of course, making a more heavy use of the HPC3 features. So we started looking into Docker and Yarn. We still have some open questions there, how we really want to do things. But we have seen, OK, it works. We ran this Confluent connector as a Docker container under Yarn. And it ingests the data from Kafka, writing it to HDFS, and running on some Hadoop node and not on the Edge nodes anymore. And also the Hive3 integration with Kafka looks really interesting for many of our projects. And of course, some of the recently, I think last year, tools by Hortonworks that were available, this data plane tools. There's this data steward service for hybrid data governance. This integrates with Atlas. We haven't tried it, but we want to look into it because we don't just want to have the metadata and data governance on a local cluster. We want to have the whole picture. And what we already tried is the data lifecycle manager for transferring data between different clusters to do this in a more easy way. So it can be done without writing manual scripts. Yeah, that's the end. Okay, the slide didn't caught you by surprise, yeah. I don't think I have to say anything about it. Any questions? Yes, please.
You talked about some of the extra work that you had to do in order to implement a solution in the public cloud. And I was wondering if you could talk about some of the choices you made or criteria that you used to decide not to use a private cloud. And if perhaps that might have avoided some of the extra work you had to do with authentication and security and things like that.
I mean, there are different reasons why to move to the cloud. And one reason for Audi to move to the cloud is that the space in our data center in Ingolstadt is really quite limited. And actually, it's really full. So if we want to extend, need new space, new computing power, we should move to the cloud. And also the process of getting new hardware into an enterprise data center and getting this hardware connected to the network and everything takes quite a lot of time. And in the cloud, you just click on a button or run a script and you have the resources. So for us, moving to the cloud it has a lot of benefits. And so the benefits clearly overweight you won't say disadvantage, but the extra work you have to do. And this is something I have to admit I really hadn't completely on my radar when we started the project. Yeah, it just then sorted out, okay, yes, okay, we need the free IPA, okay, we need a DNS, okay, like we are lucky you can do this with free IPA, we don't need an extra tool for it. That's the things we have to do. We had no, Audi is working on supplying a centralized bastion host and really confirmed official way how to access the cloud, but this wasn't available when we started last year. So we had to build up our own bastion host, do the user management there, make sure not every one of the externals has a sudo access on that host before this is really quite critical for us. Yeah, that's something to have to do. Yeah, that's true.
Then my next question, if you do that, actually for your deployment, how often do you deploy the cluster, and what else do you do with the data if it's needed to be decoupled?
Well, the question is, how do Ansible and the blueprints integrate? Because one big drawback of using Ambari Blueprints is you can use it for the initial deployment, but you cannot use it for some Delta deployment, things you can easily do with Terraform and Ansible. We can rerun our Terraform and Ansible scripts all the time. We cannot rerun this Ambari Blueprint deployment all the time, because you run it once and then you have a cluster. Yeah, that's something we are facing, and we were using the REST APIs for doing changes, because we also have some changes where we first span up the cluster and started everything in one big shot. So installing the software, starting all the services, and Ambari taking care of all the dependencies, like starting Zookeeper right in the beginning, and not because it's required by other services. We already had to break this up for some reasons. So we just use the blueprint now to install the software, configure the cluster, and then we use the REST API to start the services one by one, because in between we have to do some other changes. And what's still open, and there's still no good solution for it, at the moment it's easy, it's a development phase. So if we want to tear down our development cluster, we can tell the project, okay, just store the data you want to reuse in S3, and then we destroy the cluster, redeploy it, and you copy it back. You cannot do this with a production environment, for sure. And I think there is no easy tool or process I'm aware of. So we have to look how to automate this using the REST APIs.
Let's talk offline.
Okay. Any other questions?
What's the volume of your on-premise question?
Oof. It's, and now the production cluster is 12 data nodes. I don't know the real disk layout here anymore. It's
what version of Hadoop are you using?
We are using Hadoop 3 in the cloud, because we're still in development. We had a discussion because on-premise is still on 2.6. And as I said in the beginning, we want to keep this really in sync. And then we said, okay, the on-premise clusters, they plan to move to HTTP3 as well. So in the cloud, should we also start with 2.6, and then when we are finished, migrate, or just start with HTTP3 right away? And we started with HTTP3 right away, which is good, because we already learned a few things about some new features, some configuration things, which probably help us when we upgrade the on-premise cluster. Okay, I think time is over. Then I hope you have learned something. Enjoy the conference.